Hello everyone, good evening, welcome to today's session. Okay. So we are going to continue with our UPSC CSE MCQ series, and today we are going to cover the December 2020 current affairs through 25 MCQs. Okay, so I hope you are ready. So without any further ado, let's begin this session. I am Madhav Shankar Arvaryar. If you haven't already subscribed to this channel, please do it. And share this with, you know, other aspirants as well. Okay, so this is how it works. I will show you the question. I will give you some, you know, 20 to 30 seconds to answer each of them. If you know the answer, you can put it in the YouTube live chat. I will look into it and keep a scorecard for yourself. Okay, so that by the end of this quiz, see how much you scored out of 25. Okay. Anyway, the first question is already on the board. Consider the following statements about Article 356. Okay, statement number one, India borrowed this provision of Article 356 from the Government of India Act of 1935. Two, Mandal Commission recommended that the Article 356 should be invoked in extreme cases after exhausting all other options. Three, the SR Bommai judgment attempted to curb the blatant misuse of Article 356 of the Constitution of India. Select the correct statements. Okay, so there has been some certain incidents regarding judiciary, some constitutional experts were saying that judiciary, Andhra Pradesh High Court had actually overreached in its judgment regarding 356, etc. So that is the reason why it was in the news. And the Andhra Pradesh Chief Minister himself wrote to the Chief Justice of India against the HC judgment and all. Okay. And this is a very important part of your polity. Good evening, Satya. So if you know the answer, put it in the live chat, okay? Once I get a couple of answers, I will explain it and we will move on to the next question. Nothing so far. Okay, so the correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 3 only. Okay, so India borrowed this provision of Article 356 from the Government of India Act of 1935. This is correct. What is exactly Article 356? What does it deal with? It deals with President's rule. Okay, 352 is a national emergency, 356 is the President's rule, and 60 is the financial emergency. Okay, 360 is the financial emergency. So Article 356 deals with President's rule, and it is actually borrowed from Government of India Act of 1935. Okay, that is correct. Statement 3 is also correct. The SR Bommai judgment attempt to curb the blatant misuse of 356 of the Constitution of India. So earlier, you know, there was a misuse of this particular article by the, you know, certain central governments in order to control a particular state which may be ruled by a different political party. Okay, so blatantly Article 356 began to be misused, and SR Bommai judgment, the very famous judgment by the Supreme Court, actually tried to curb such blatant misuse. Second one is wrong. It is not Mandal Commission. Mandal Commission deals with what? Reservations and all those, you know, things, etc. Okay, it is actually the Sarkaria Commission. Sarkaria Commission recommended that Article 356 should be invoked in extreme cases after exhausting all other options. Clear? So the correct answer is option C. Second question, another one from your polity. Consider the following statements regarding Uniform Civil Code, UCC. Number one, it is based on the premise that there is no connection between religion and law in modern civilization. Two, the term Uniform Civil Code is explicitly mentioned in Part 4, Article 44 of the Indian Constitution. Select the correct answer. Okay, second question. If you know the answer, please put it in the chat box. I will look into it. Okay. Uniform Civil Code is very important. Lots of comments has been happening in this topic as well in the recent past. Any guesses? Okay, Satya is saying it is C, both 1 and 2. And the correct answer is yes. Very good. It is option C, 1 and 2. So basically, it is based on the premise that there is no connection between religion and law in modern civilization. That is correct. Okay, no connection between religion and law. So a uniform civil code for everybody. We already have a uniform criminal code, but as far as civil codes are concerned, you know, different religion, etc., etc., have different kinds of civil codes. So we are trying to standardize that as well. That is the idea behind UCC. Second one, the term uniform civil code is explicitly mentioned in part 4 of Article 44 of the Indian Constitution. Part 4 or Article 44 of the Indian Constitution. That is also correct. Okay. So a uniform civil code means that all sections of the society, irrespective of their religion, shall be treated equally according to a national civil code, which shall be applicable to all uniformity. Okay, irrespective of the religion, everybody will be treated equally as far as civil code is concerned. And it covers areas like marriage, divorce, maintenance, inheritance, adoption, succession of property, and all these things. Okay, right now, you know, Hindus has a method of marriage, Islam has different, Christians has different. Okay, regarding the diverse laws, it's all different. So once this code comes into play, everything will be unified. Okay, so here the correct answer is both A and B. Question 3. Consider the following statements about Roshni Act. Okay, number 1. It was enacted in 2019 by the Union Government and sought to regularize unauthorized land. 2. As per the Act, the erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir, the ownership of land would be transferred to its occupants on the payment of a fee fixed by the government. 3. The proceeds were to be used for hydropower projects for generating electricity. Select the correct statements. Okay, Satya, sorry regarding that. Both in the previous question, both the statements are correct only, okay? If it was asked as incorrect question, I'm sorry regarding this. Both these are correct. Okay, I will change the question here. Okay, if it is asked as incorrect, then answer is D, none of the above, because both these 1 and 2 are correct. Okay, Deepika, welcome. Deepika saying it is C, 1 and 2. All right. Others? Third question, Roshni Act. Correct answer is option A, 2 and 3. All right, so this Roshni Act is nothing new. Okay. The first statement says that it was enacted by Union Government 2019. So we might actually think that, you know, when Jammu and Kashmir, the special powers was abrogated, when Article 370 was abrogated, Union Government came up with all these things. No, actually Roshni Act was enacted in 2001 by the government of Jammu and Kashmir, which was led by Farooq Abdullah at that time, about 20 years ago. Okay. And the second, so first statement is wrong. Other two are correct. As per this act, the ownership rights of land would be transferred to its occupants on payment of a fixed fee by the government. Okay. And in case of agricultural land, the ownership was for free. Without any kind of payment, you will be getting the ownership, except for a certain minor documentation fee, you know, regarding the transactions and all. Okay. For agricultural lands, this transfer of land will be completely free except for the documentation fee. In other cases, government will fix a particular amount, and once you pay it, the land ownership will be given to you based on certain criteria. The proceeds were to be used for hydropower projects for generating electricity. Also correct. Okay, so why was this in the news? This was in the news because High Court, the Jammu and Kashmir High Court actually cut down this particular act, saying that due to various reasons. Also, plenty of allegations were there into this act. A CAG report itself said that this act has been misused by, you know, politicians and influential people to their own needs. Okay, so plenty of news regarding Roshni Act. It has been all over the news in the last year. So do look into it and study it very well. Okay. Question 4. Consider the following statements about submarine cables. Okay. Number 1. Submarine optical fiber networks exhibit lower latency as compared to satellite communications. 2. However, the total carrying capacity of submarine cables is in the kilobits per second, which is much lower than that through satellites. Select the correct answer. So this is a science and tech question. Submarine cables. Okay, first statement is regarding latency and second statement is regarding the carrying capacity of information. We have 25 questions. This is a 1 hour session. We will wrap it up by 6 p.m. Okay. Any idea? Okay. So, correct answer to fourth question is, okay, Neema, welcome. Neema is saying it is B. Fine. Correct answer is indeed B. Very good. Okay. So, the total carrying capacity of submarine cables is in the terabits per second, which is much higher than that is possible through satellites. Clear? So, in the second statement, it is saying that the total carrying capacity is kilobits per second. It is not kilobits. It's much, much higher. It is terabits. Okay. And this is way too larger than what is possible using a satellite. So, this is much more preferential. Currently, 99% of the data traffic that cross the oceans is carried through undersea cables. Clear? So, it has better, you know, or lower latency as compared to satellite communications, and also it has a better carrying capacity. That is why 99% of data traffic that happens through the oceans is done through submarine cables. So, the answer is option B. So, when you study about submarine cables, do look into optical fiber networks, and you know, total internal reflection, etc., etc. Also important. Question 5. Consider the following statements about Kisan Rail. Okay. Statement number 1. It is an undertaking by Indian Railways for the development of a national coal supply chain for the transportation of fertilizer packages. 2. Indian Railways will set up Kisan Rail as an entirely public company. Select the correct answer. Okay, regarding Kisan Rail, select the correct answer. Make sure you are all in the live session. Make sure you are not lagging behind or anything. Okay. Fifth question, so far no answers. Kisan Rail. Okay, Neema Bhatt is saying it is C. Both are correct. Okay. Correct answer to fifth question is none of the above. Option D. Alright, so it is an undertaking by Indian Railways. Okay, Kisan Rail. So it has to do with railways. So Indian Railways. For the development of a national coal supply chain, for the transportation of what? Not fertilizers, it is actually perishable substances. Okay, perishable traffic. So the kisans or the agriculturists or the farmers, once they, you know, produce all the fruits, vegetables, etc., etc., which has to be transported for a very long distance and all, these kinds of trains will help. Okay, these kinds of trains will have exclusive, you know, cold storage compartments and all. And so these food items can be, you know, translocated to longer distances. That is the idea. Second statement is also wrong. Indian Railways will set up Kisan Rail not as a public company but in a PPP fashion. PPP means what? Public private partnership. Okay, PPP model will be implemented for this purpose. And the government of India also has extended a subsidy of 50% on transportation of fruits and vegetables. Clear? So this is Kisan Rail. Just think about it. If you are having a cold storage or cold supply chain, why would you give that to fertilizers? You would use that for perishable goods. So the perishable goods produced by farmers are, you know, fruits, vegetables, and you know these kinds of things, na. So this was this could have been tackled in a logical fashion as well. Anyway, the correct answer here is option D. Okay. Question number 6. Consider the following statements about sedimentary basins. Number 1. Sedimentary basins are the primary locations on the continents where sufficient subsidence exists for long-term preservation of continental sediments. 2. Almost all the world's natural gas and petroleum and all of its coal are found in sedimentary rock. Select the correct answer. I request all of you who are online to actively participate so that you know it would be more interactive. Even if you don't know the exact answer, try answering. Okay, try to make intelligent guesses. Even in UPSC exam, you may not know the exact answer to every question. You will have to make intelligent guesses there as well. So practice that using these questions. Sedimentary basins, again in the news very recently. 6th question. Okay, no, okay, Nima B, Satya C. Alright, so what is the correct answer? It is C. Both are true. Okay, both are correct. Sedimentary basins are the primary locations on the continents where sufficient subsidence exists for long-term preservation of continental sediments. Correct. So why is it this in the news? Because Bengal Basin became India's 8th producing basin. So what happens is these sedimentary rocks, you know, these are very important to us for oil and natural gas explorations. Okay, and very recently in Bengal, the Bengal Basin has been made the 8th producing basin of India. As the sediments are buried, they are subject to increasing pressure and begin the process of compaction and lithification that transform them into sedimentary rock. Okay, this is also related to geography. So study about sedimentary rocks, igneous rocks, metamorphic rocks, etc., etc. Clear? Almost all the world's natural gas and petroleum and all of its coal are found in sedimentary rock. That's how it happens, right? You know, plant or an animal, you know, animals get buried, you know, dead plants and animals get buried over a long time, and eventually it becomes petroleum products, natural gas, etc., etc. Okay, so this is very common sense. We have studied this in younger classes. And first statement is basically the definition of a sedimentary basin. Answer is option C. Also remember, it is Bengal which has been recently added as the 8th producing basin of India. Okay, question number 7. Consider the following statements regarding India and Nepal. Okay, number 1. India is Nepal's second largest trading partner after China. 2. Currently, India and Nepal border Currently, India and Nepal border is settled except for disputes over Kalapani Limpiadura Lipule Trijunction between India, Nepal and China. Select the correct answer. So in one of the previous quizzes also, I had asked the question regarding Nepal that was associated with, you know, Kalapani region and Treaty of Segauli, etc., etc. Okay, so if you have read on that topic, you will definitely get the answer to this one. Question number 7. Don't hold back, just try to answer it anyway and put your answers in the YouTube live chat. Okay, Deepika, welcome. Deepika is saying it is B. Satya also going with B. So correct answer to 7th question is D. None of the above. Alright, so India is Nepal's second largest trading partner after China. No, India is the largest trading partner of Nepal. Okay, Himalayas, make sure that is the case. Clear? India is largest trading partner of Nepal. So first statement is incorrect. Second statement, there are actually two areas of contention. One is the Kalapani Limpiadura Lipule Trijunction. Other one is the Sustha area. Okay, this one, Kalapani Rimpiyadra Lipule Tri Junction is based on the River Kali. Okay, River Kali. And there is another one, that's the Sustha area. Sustha area, which is in Western Champaran district of Bihar. Clear? This is another region of contention. So these two are the two areas. This statement says that currently India-Nepal border is settled except for this particular one region. There are actually two areas of contention. Okay. So the answer is option D. Question 8. Idea of D10 group of nations put forward by which among the following nations to develop 5G technology as a counter to Chinese company Huawei's dominance in technology. Okay. So D10 means democratic group of 10. Alright. And this is actually a concept or a group of nations which has been put forth by a particular nation in order to counter Chinese dominance in the 5G technology. Okay, so which is the nation which put forward the idea of D10? Option A, Germany. Option B, United States of America. Option C, United Kingdom. Option D, none of the above. Alright, Satya, Deepika, everybody going with C. Yes, so you know this. Very good. Alright, it is indeed the United Kingdom. Prabha, welcome. Okay, Prabha also getting the correct answer. I was expecting most of you to go with option B, USA. But all of you got this right. It is indeed the correct answer. It is UK. Okay, actually the D10 Club of Democratic Partners includes 10 countries. The G7 plus Australia, South Korea and India. India is also there. Okay, don't forget. That is why it is important for us. Okay, G7 plus 3, that is Australia, South Korea and India. Which are the G7 nations? That also you have to study. I have given it here. UK, US, Italy, Germany, France, Japan and Canada. Okay, anyway. Question number 9. Bashan Shah is a 13,000 acre expanse mudflat land that was recently across the news. This is situated in which among the following nations? Option A, Afghanistan. Option B, Bangladesh. Option C, Libya. Option D, Israel. Bashan Shah is situated in which among the following nations? Question number 9. I expect all of you to give the correct answer here also. Satya going with option B, Bangladesh. Nima Bhatt, okay. Alright, so we had already discussed regarding Bashan Shah in a previous quiz regarding a different question. At that time, the question was different regarding Rohingyas. Okay, while we were talking about Rohingyas also regarding the Cox Island and all. So, Bashan Shah is actually in Bangladesh. Okay, so the Bangladesh government's move to relocate Rohingyas to the newly built facility in Bashan Shah Island, this became the headlines. Okay, the mudflat is formed by accumulation of silt where the river Meghna meets the Bay of Bengal, carrying rich alluvial deposits. Okay, the name of the river is important. It is Meghna River. Okay, so the answer is option B. It is one of the biggest refugee areas in the world, Bashan Shah. It's a mudflat. We can't call it an island. In newspapers and all, generally we use the terminology island. But to be more accurate, it is a mudflat that is formed due to the siltation by the river Meghna. Okay, so the answer is option B. Question 10. Which among the following best describes CATSA? Option A, a sanction program by USA. Option B, NASA mission to study exoplanets. Option C, an experimental drug for COVID-19. Option D, exploratory mission in Arctic and Antarctic. Select the correct answer. CATSA. CATSA has been very often in the news for the past 4-5 years. Satya quickly going with A, Deepika A, Neema A. Okay, so all of you know this. Donald Trump used to put CATSA in with almost, any nation that he likes. So, correct answer is option A. It is actually a sanction program by US government. And it has been imposed on Iran, North Korea and Russia. So, basically, it includes sanctions against any countries that engage in significant transactions with Russian defense and intelligence sectors. Okay, that is the prime idea behind CATSA. Any country that engaged with, you know, in a significant manner with Russian defense and intelligence sectors gets imposed with CATSA. The US has been using this to sanction various nations, Iran, North Korea, and Russia being the prime targets. Okay, so the answer is option A. 11th question. Consider the following statements about Dhokra art. Number one, it is an iron metal casting using the lost wax technique of casting. Two, one of the earliest known lost wax artifact is the dancing girl found at Harappa. Select the correct statements. Welcome, Sisindal Devi. Yeah, so 10th question, everyone got it right. 9th also, 8th also. So a series of easy questions, I guess. Question 11. Okay, Deepika going with A. Again, do intelligent guesses. Neema A. Satya D. Srisindal Devi D. Alright, correct answer indeed option D. Okay, I mean, I'm happy of the fact that nobody thought statement 2 is correct. Okay, I mean, everybody was of the opinion statement 2 is wrong. So that's good. So your history is pretty solid. Okay, so that, you know, the dancing girl, which is indeed a creation using the lost wax technique, is not found at Harappa, it's found at Mohenjo-Daro. Okay, that everybody knows. So all of you got that part correct. First statement is also incorrect because it is not an iron metal casting. Okay, it is not an iron metal casting. It is actually a bronze and copper casting. So usually the term we use is non-ferrous metal casting. And the metals are bronze and copper. Okay, I mean, even the dancing girl, you can think about it. It is not made of iron. Clear? So the answer is option D, none of the above. And this Dhokra art is popular in all parts of India. It originated in West Bengal, but it is now it is very popular in almost the entire India. Okay. Question 12. Consider the following statements about Gurudwara Rakab Ganj Sahib. Number 1. The mortal remains of Guru Gobind Singh, the 10th Sikh Guru, were cremated at Gurudwara Rakab Ganj. 2. The Gurudwara was constructed in 1783 after Sikh military leader Bhagel Singh Dhaliwal captured Delhi. Select the correct answer. Gurudwara Rakab Ganj Sahib. Thank you, Srisindal Devi. Question 12. Gurudwara Rakab Ganj Sahib. So why is this in the news? This is in the news because our Prime Minister Narendra Modi visited this particular Gurudwara. That is why it is in the news. Alright, Deepika saying it is C. Satya B. Fine. Correct answer to 12th question is option B. Very good. Okay, the Gurudwara was constructed in 1783 after Sikh military leader Bhagel Singh Dhaliwal captured Delhi. That is true. But this Gurudwara does not contain the remains of Guru Gobind Singh, the 10th Sikh Guru, but instead it is a 9th Sikh Guru, Guru Tegh Bahadur. Okay, it's the mortal remains of 9th Sikh Guru, Guru Tegh Bahadur, that is in Gurudwara Rakab Ganj Sahib. So our Prime Minister Narendra Modi went there to pay respects to Guru Tegh Bahadur. That is why it came in the news, and we have to look into it. Okay, so 12 questions done. 13th one, we have 25 questions. 13th one, consider the following statements about Chang'e 5. Okay, Chang'e 5. 1. It is the first attempt by any nation to retrieve samples from the moon in 4 decades. 2. The Chinese probe is expected to collect 2 kg of surface material from a previously unexplored area known as Oceanus Procellarum. Select the correct statements. Question number 13, Chang'e 5, a science and technology area question. Just think about it. Neema saying it is B, 2 only. Srisindal Devi C. second. Put this in silent. Okay, Satya B, Deepika D, correct answer is indeed option C. So, Shishindal Devi, good job, correct answer. Actually, Chang'e 5 is the first attempt by any nation to retrieve samples from the moon in 4 decades. Read the entire statement. Okay, it doesn't stop here. It has this last part also, in 4 decades. So, when was the last time US landed in the moon? That's back in 1969. So, it has been more than 40 years since that happened. Okay, so this is the first attempt by any nation to retrieve samples from the moon in 4 decades. Yes, correct. Second one, the Chinese probe is expected to collect 2 kilograms of surface material from a previously unexplored area. Also correct. And this area is known as Oceanus Procellarum and also known as Ocean of the Stones, which consists of a vast lava region. Okay, if China actually will become the third country to do this if it succeeds. Previously, USA and Soviet Union are the only two nations which has managed to do this. Clear? So the answer is option C. Both the statements are correct. Question 14. Consider the statements about Bhabha Atomic Research Center, BARC. Number 1. BARC functions under the Department of Science and Technology. 2. Eye cancer therapy in the form of the first intravenous ruthenium-106 plaque for the treatment of ocular tumors has been developed by BARC. Select the correct answer. Okay, Bhabha Atomic Research Center. Question 14. Shishindal Devi quickly going with option B. Satya as well. Okay. So, correct answer. Do you need more time? Okay, Deepika B, Neema D. Okay, correct answer is option B. Alright, so this is correct. Eye cancer therapy. This is why BARC is in the news now. Okay, for eye cancer therapy, BARC actually developed an indigenous thing known as ruthenium-106 plaque. So basically, you are placing a radioactive substance within your body. Okay, that is known as brachytherapy. So this has been developed by BARC in order to cure eye cancer, for eye cancer therapy. Okay, so that part is true. First part is wrong. It is not Department of Science and Technology. It is Department of Atomic Energy. Clear? BARC comes under Department of Atomic Energy. We have a separate department for that, for atomic energy area. So the answer is option B. So study about, you know, Homi J. Bhabha and all these things. Okay, even Vikram Sarabhai. Even Vikram Sarabhai has contributed for the development of BARC. How, etc. Read on it. Very important. Question 15. Consider the following statements about Himalayan Trillium. Okay, a question from Environment and Ecology. Himalayan Trillium. 1. The Himalayan Trillium is a rare bird that has been declared endangered by IUCN. 2. It is seen in temperate and subalpine zones of the Himalayas at an altitude of 2400 meters to 1400 meters and is endemic to India. Select the correct answer. Himalayan Trillium. Again, this is not a static portion. Okay, I mean, you might think that this comes from a static portion, but Himalayan Trillium has been in the news. That's why I took it. Okay, already got an answer, 15B. Fine. Anybody else? Neema B, Satya D. Okay, I got 3 answers. So, Deepika also going with B. Correct answer? D. Very good, Satya. Correct answer is D. Himalayan Trillium is a rare bird. This is where it is wrong. Okay, it is indeed endangered and all, but Himalayan Trillium is actually a herb. It is a plant species. Okay, it's not at all a bird. It is a herb. Okay, second one, it is seen in temperate and at subalpine zones of Himalayas at an altitude of 2400 meters to 4000 meters. Yes, up to here this statement is correct. Last part is wrong. It is endemic to India. No, it is seen in other countries as well. Afghanistan, Pakistan, China, Nepal, Bhutan, etc. So, just think about it. where all Himalayas passes, and you can see this throughout Himalayas. Okay, endemic to India means it should be confined to that particular region, India only. But it is actually present in more than like 5 countries. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 countries actually. Okay, so the answer here is option D, none of the above. Last 10 questions. Question 16. Consider the following statements about lion-tailed macaque. Another question, again from ecology. And let's see. Statement number 1. It is endemic to the rainforest of Western Ghats and spreads over 3 states, Tamil Nadu, Karnataka and Kerala. 2. Unlike other macaques, it typically avoids humans when possible. 3. It is categorized as endangered in the IUCN Red List. Select the correct answer. Lion-tailed macaque. Session will be saying all these are correct. Fine. Others. Deepika also saying the same. Prabha also. Okay. Everybody is saying that everything is correct, and indeed, all of you got it right. Very good. All these statements are correct. Again, just read the animals that are in the endangered and critically endangered list. Okay. So that you will, you could at least remember, or you will have some idea if that's true or not. Clear? So all these statements are correct. Okay, it is endemic to the rainforest of Western Ghats, and it is seen only in 3 states: Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and Kerala. And unlike other macaques, it avoids human whenever possible. Also correct. It is categorized as endangered in the IUCN Red List. It is also there in Appendix 1 of CITES. Okay, because it is in Appendix 1 of CITES, international trade of this animal is illegal. Clear? So, answer is option D, all the above. 17th question. Consider the following statements about mucormycosis. Okay, mucormycosis. Number 1. It is a serious but rare bacterial infection caused by mucormycetes. 2. It mainly affects people who have health problems or take medicines that lower the body's ability to fight germs and sickness. Select the correct answer. Since the COVID-19 issue is going on, everybody is behind this that particular disease only. But there are plenty of other diseases in the news as well, and this is one of them. Mucormycosis. Okay. So choose the correct answer. 17, already got a couple of answers. Deepika, Satya, Srisindadevi, all saying it is B. Neema saying C, Prabha also saying it is B. Correct answer is B. Very good. So you are very prepared for today, okay? Plenty of correct answers from all of you. Very good. Answer is B. It is not a bacterial infection. It is actually a fungal infection. That's all. Okay, whenever you study about a disease, make sure you study what is causing it. What if it is a pathogen, then what is it? Is it mice, or is it a rabbit, or say mosquito? If it is a mosquito, which kind of mosquito? Anopheles, or Culex, Aedes, aegypti, etc., etc. Okay, so second statement is more or less vague. So even if you have no clue about this, you might as well go with it. Okay, so first statement was the factual one. So if you know the answer to that statement, you might as well give the correct answer. Correct answer here is option B. Question 18. Consider the following statements about Digital Ocean. 1. Digital Ocean is a web-based application developed by INCOIS of the Ministry of Earth Sciences. 2. It is the first of its kind digital platform for ocean data management. Select the correct answer. 18th question. Regarding Digital Ocean, choose the correct answer. I'll give you 20 to 30 seconds. Listen, they'll be quickly going with option A, Deepika A, Satya B. Alright, I think, Prabha giving me the correct answer, which is option C. Both are true. Okay, in the previous 4-5 questions, All of you were getting everything correct, and then I think I jinxed it, okay? And this time only one got it right. Answer is option C, both 1 and 2. DigitalOcean is a web-based application developed by InCoEs and of the Ministry of Earth Sciences, yes. And it is the first of its kind digital platform for ocean data management, also correct. So basically, it creates, you know, a web-based integration of, you know, 3D and 4D visualization of ocean floor and, you know, various sections of the ocean, etc., etc. Okay, so both the statements are correct. Answer is option C. I have given a, you know, brief description about the same here. I will upload the PDF of this, is in this one, in my Telegram channel. The link is given here, also underneath the in the description section of YouTube. You can click that link and download the PDF of this sessions. Okay. Question 19. Very easy question. Probably the easiest question of this quiz. The Sentinelese is a pre-Neolithic people who have inhabited Earth for an estimated 55,000 years without contact with the outside world. Where is this tribe found? Option A, Lakshadweep. Option B, Andaman and Nicobar. Option C, Jharkhand. Option D, Mizoram. Sentinelese tribe. Deepika going with B, Neema going with B, Chesindra Devi B. Okay, so pretty simple question. We all have heard about this particular tribal people. This is, you know, Sentinelese are, yeah, the correct answer is indeed Andaman and Nicobar Islands. There are barely like 50 to 100 individuals left. Okay, and they are pretty much hostile to outside world. So whenever government of India or, you know, anybody has tried to contact, establish a contact with them, they always reacted in a very hostile manner, and they are still cut off from the rest of the world. Okay, so the historians actually say that if you want to study regarding, you know, Stone Age and all, you can actually study these people, because these people are still continuing most of that practices, primitive practices. They do not know the world that is happening all around the globe. Okay, so this is also one among the 70 PVTGs across the country. I hope you know what a PVTG is, particularly vulnerable tribal group. Okay, what is it? Do look into it. Okay. Also, Sentinelese are among the 5 PVTGs in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and others are Great Andamanese, the Om, Jarawa, and Shompen. All these 5 tribes are seen in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Okay, so the answer here is option B. 20th question. Another simple one. Global Environment Outlook is released by which among the following agencies? Option A, United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change. Option B, United Nations Development Program. Option C, United Nations Environment Program. Option D, World Wild Fund. 20th question. After this, we have only 5 more to go. All right, Satya saying C, Srisindal Devi with A. Waiting for a couple of answers. Deepika C. Correct answer, option C. World Global Environment Outlook is published by United Nations Environment Program. Okay. It's not UN FCCC. It is actually UNEP. Do study about reports and all these things. Very important. Publications, reports, etc., etc. Okay. Usually, a question will definitely come from this area. Last year, it wasn't there, I think. But other than that, barring last year, I have seen one question regarding reports, etc., reports, indices and all. Okay, at least one question is usually seen in the UPSC prelims paper. So correct answer here is option C. Last 5 questions. Consider the following statements about Western Ghats. Number 1, Western Ghats is spread across 7 states. 2, Western Ghats is one of the biodiversity hotspots of India. 3, Western Ghats is listed among the UNESCO World Heritage Sites. Choose the correct answer. Very simple question, right? One supplementary question that I am going to ask you. Can you name one committee that looked into the stability of Western Ghats? That studied the ecological and environmental impacts in Western Ghats? There are actually two committees that looked into it. Can you name at least one of them? If you know it, please put it in the YouTube chat session. Okay, 21st question, B, B, B. Everybody going with option B. Kasturi Rangan committee, very good, Deepika. One more is there, which is the most famous one. Kasturi Rangan came after this one. The first committee report was extremely, you know, very strict and all, and so the governments did not like it. So they tried using another one, that is the Kasturi Rangan committee, which was much more comparatively liberal. The other one is exactly Satya Pandey correct. It is the Madhav Gadgil committee that looked into Western Ghats. Okay, both of you very good. Madhav Gadgil committee and Kasturi Rangan committee. There is another Kasturi Rangan committee. Does anybody know it? K Kasturi Rangan committee is related to what? Another question for you. Yasima also got it. Very good. K Kasturi Rangan committee is related to what? Something that happened. Yes, very good, Deepika, Seema. It is related to not just education. The proper answer is National Education Policy, New Education Policy, NEP. NEP 2020. New Education Policy of 2020. The initial report was given by K. Kasturi Rangan. Okay, so here 21st question, correct answer indeed option B, because Western Ghats cover 8 states. Okay, not 7. And these 8 states, 6 states, not 7. And these are Gujarat, Maharashtra, Goa, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu and Kerala. You can roughly, you know, look into it visually, you know, the western coast of India and think about it. Answer is option B. These two are correct. Everybody knows that. Okay, so the only area where this could go wrong is the statement number 1. And the number is not 7, it is 6. 22nd question, another index. Human Freedom Index is released by which among the following agencies? Option A, German Watch. Option B, Amnesty International. Option C, Reporters Without Borders. Option D, Cato and Fraser. Yes, very good, Seema. Alright, Deepika saying it is A, Neema saying it is C. Human Freedom Index, very important, again in the news. Seema also going with A. Others, there are 7 people online. So I expect more answers. Prabha, C. Okay, so I think that's a point for me. Answer is option D, Cato and Fraser. Okay, yeah, Satya Pandey got it. Human Freedom Index is actually, published by an American think tank called Cato Institute along with a Canadian think tank called Fraser Institute. Okay, so Cato Institute and Fraser Institute together comes out with the Human Freedom Index report. So the answer is option D, none of the others. Clear? Last 3 questions, 23rd one. Consider the following statements. Number 1. Madhya Pradesh has the longest network of national highways in India. 2. National Highway 44 or the NH44 is the longest running national highway in India. Select the correct answer. Deepika going with option B. Satya also going with B. Prabha again B. Seema confused but still going with B. So correct answer, yes, indeed it is B. Can you tell me how to make the first statement correct? It is not Madhya Pradesh. Which state is it? Answer is B only, okay? I will show you the return answer, but before that, let me see if you know it. We are ahead of time, so we have Maharashtra, okay? Any other guesses? Maharashtra is the wrong answer. It's not Maharashtra. It's another state. Longest network of national highways in India. Nobody else? Yes, Deepika correct. It is Uttar Pradesh. Okay, UP has the longest network of national highways in India. And NH44 is actually the longest running national highway in India. So the answer is option B. Yeah, Srinagar, Srinagar, Kanyakumari, correct. Prabha, correct. It runs from Srinagar to Kanyakumari. NH44 is the longest one. Penultimate question for the day regarding cyclones and the area which affected, which was affected with the cyclone. Gati, Somalia and Yemen. Burevi, Malaysia. Amphan, India and Bangladesh. Nivar, India and Sri Lanka. Select the correctly matched pair using the codes given below. Okay, I will rearrange the question. Okay, I think this one, the answer is not here. Okay, sorry for it. Correct answer is actually in question slide is actually incorrect. Okay, this was supposed to be the question slide. I mixed it up. Anyway, the correct answer here is 3 and 4. Because Gati is actually in Somalia and Yemen. I am not waiting for your answers because there was an error in the choice. Okay, Gati happened in Somalia and Yemen. Burevi in India, Sri Lanka. Amphan and Nivar, we know. Very recently in the news, both happened in India and one in, you know, northeast regions, so near to Bangladesh. Other one in the Tamil Nadu area and Sri Lankan region. Okay, Nivar and Amphan. Gati happened in Somalia and Yemen, nothing related to India. Okay, so the correct answer here is option C. Final question for the day, question 25. Consider the following statements. Number 1, the Great Indian Bustards are classified as near threatened under IUCN classification. 2, their habitats include swampy areas, mangroves, lakes, etc., etc. Select the correct answer. So one more thing, the next one would be NCERT history session that will happen very soon. We have after revolt of 1857, we have not taken the next chapter. So that will happen next, probably Tuesday. Okay, we will see when I get the time. But afterwards, the next after that, we will again come back to current affairs and we will take January 2021 current affairs. Now 1 month each. Okay. January 2021 current affairs will be the next one, so start studying it. We will take that on Wednesday or Thursday, most probably Wednesday. Okay, 25th question, everybody gave me the answer option A and Deepika going with option D. Correct answer, yes, option D. Prabha also giving me the correct answer. Great Indian bustards are classified as critically endangered. Their population is extremely less. Okay, it is not threatened. So again, I repeatedly ask you the same thing. Read the species which are categorized as critically endangered and endangered. So if that species, you know, once you read it, you will have some kind of idea of that name, right? I mean, you would remember it at least in a very vague manner. So if you have read it, you will know that it is either in critically endangered or not in or endangered. If you have not read it, then you can be sure that it is not critically endangered or endangered. It is something else, near threatened or vulnerable or something like that. Okay, so read all the species that comes under critically endangered and endangered. Just read the names, that's enough. So first statement is wrong. Second one, their habitats include swampy areas, mangroves. No, their habitats actually include dry grasslands and scrublands. They are mostly seen in Rajasthan region in India, also certain regions in Pakistan. So it's they prefer a, you know, drier climate, a drier habitat, not mangroves and swamps and all these things. Okay, so both the statements are incorrect. Answer is option D. So that's it, guys. Thank you for joining, everyone. If you haven't liked this video already, please do it and also subscribe this channel, hit the bell icon and suggest this to your friends also. Okay, thank you for joining. I will upload this PDF in 5 minutes into this Telegram channel. And until next time, bye bye.